Hello friends, good evening. Myself Pushpendu Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs. So as you know, these lectures are useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the UPSC. All right, and we are referring the two national newspapers, the Hindu or Indian Express. You can also refer these newspapers, any of these newspapers. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can subscribe to our channel on the YouTube also, right? So that you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news about, you know, some sort of a proceedings or insolvency proceedings against the personal guarantors, right? So here the Supreme Court upheld the government notification. That government notification basically allowed the personal guarantors who provide the guarantee, right, for the basically financial institutions or the banks for providing the credit available to those, you know, to those basically debtors. So here what is happening is that the government has provided a notification on November 15, 2019 regarding the insolvency proceedings or to recover the pending due or recover the pending, you know, the loans which are lying with those debtors. Now the debtors basically moved to the Supreme Court regarding that notification. How come the personal guarantors could be equally, you know, treated with those, you know, with those basically, you know, with those corporate entities, right, which have really taken the loans from the financial entities? So here the government basically upheld the government notification regarding the insolvency proceedings to be moved against also those personal guarantors who have given the guarantee for the purpose of these loans, right, for the purpose of recovering of these stressed corporate assets, right, you know, from the banks which have been taken, right. So here the personal guarantors could also be, you know, treated, right, as per with, you know, the corporates which have taken the loans under the Indian Bankruptcy Insolvency Code, right, and that notification was found legal and valid by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. Okay, so let us understand what is this about promoters, right? We are talking about the promoters of the big businesses. The promoters are basically the directors, chairpersons, right, or chairmen, right, who stand as a personal guarantor to the corporate loans. Okay, and the Supreme Court recently held that such chairperson or such chairman or the directors who have held a personal guarantor would also be, you know, proceeded against, you know, the company law tribunal for the purpose for the repayment of the loans. So here the insolvency proceedings that we are talking about in this first paragraph, right, insolvency proceedings are basically, you know, collective term that we basically use for the official, you know, for the purpose of the recovering of this due, right, for the official legal mechanism, right. It include, you know, the binding up, liquidation, or some sort of a changes in the company administration, receivership, or individual or bankruptcy, like whatever is that, all such, you know, it's an umbrella term that's basically used for that purpose. Okay, and regarding insolvency and bankruptcy code that we are talking in the second paragraph, it is basically, you know, seeks to consolidate the existing framework by creating a single law, right, for this purpose of insolvency and the bankruptcy. All right, so here, you know, the Honorable Supreme Court has held that there is an intrinsic connection between the personal guarantors as well as these corporate debtors, right? These personal guarantors are basically chairpersons, the managing directors, and whatever it may be who have given the guarantee for the purpose of loans. So this intimate connection basically allow, right, the government to proceed against such personal guarantors also under insolvency and bankruptcy code, right? And again, Honorable Supreme Court also says that the guarantors or the personal guarantors would also be liable to come to the forum that is called National Company Law Tribunal, right? It will be, they will be also treated as par with the corporate debtors for the purpose of this adjudicatory process. Okay, and section 16(2) of the code or insolvency and bankruptcy code also require such bankruptcy proceedings would also be proceed against such personal guarantors apart from that the corporate debtors. So let us understand about the National Company Law Tribunal. The National Company Law Tribunal is basically a quasi-judicial body. Why we call the quasi-judicial body? Because it does not have the fully judicial character. So it is a quasi-judicial body, right? Okay, fine. Now it adjudicate the process or it adjudicate the issues related to the Indian company. So you could see that this tribunal was established under the Company Act 2013. All right. and it was constituted on the 1st June 2016, right, by the government of India, right? And this company law tribunal, or the national company law tribunal, basically is the adjudicative authority for the insolvency proceedings or for insolvency resolutions, right? Under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. That's what we are talking about, this national company law tribunal under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. Okay, here the Supreme Court has basically given the verdict. The Supreme Court basically dismissed those challenges which are basically challenged the government notification, right, in 2019 regarding those, you know, the personal guarantors, right, that will be also suable or the, you know, brought before this national company law tribunal for the purpose of recovering of those debt, right? Here the decision would definitely boost the banks, because the banks are having a lot of stress assets, crores of the rupees of the stress assets, that would basically help the banks to recover those stress assets also, right? Here the promoters and the, you know, all such parties would be taken as a guarantor, would also be, you know, they would also be not able to escape from the clutches of the law, right? Because they are able to, you know, escape from the clutches of the law by saying that we are not, you know, the exact corporate debtor, but we are just promoters. So now they would not be able to get away from that clutches of the law. All right. Next, the Sundar Lal Bahuguna. Sundar Lal Bahuguna was basically a noted environmentalist. He recently died because of COVID-19 complications. He was 94 years of the old, and he was basically the Gandhian follower also. Okay. So Sundar Lal Bahuguna was born in 1927. He died in 2021 because of COVID-19 complications. He was the Garhwali. That means he basically belongs to the Uttarakhand, right? And he was a noted environmentalist, and he was also the founder of the Chipko movement, or, you know, Chipko means the hugging of the trees, right? That movement was started, right, in 1970s to save the Himalayan forest from cutting down by the forest contractors. So what was happened that this Chipko movement was basically a non-violent social and ecological movement, right, that was started by the rural villagers, right, particularly the women, right? And that movement was started by basically Sundar Lal Bahuguna, right, with the help of those, you know, villagers. Now here the government basically have planned to have those logging type of, you know, cutting down of this forest. So government backed these loggers basically, or the contractors came for cutting down the forest, and there this environmentalist, you know, Sundar Lal Bahuguna came in between, and basically he saved the trees. And this movement was spread all around, you know, the Himalayan region, throughout the Himalayan region. And that was the Uttarakhand that was at the point of the time in 1973, precisely, that was a part of Uttar Pradesh at that point of the time. So the Chipko means to hug or to cling to. So the women, right, those people basically, they hug to the trees, right? They stop the contractors from cutting down those trees at that point of the time, right? So that is what, you know, we call as a Chipko movement, right? All right. And he also spearheaded the anti-Tehri Dam movement, right? So that was started in 1980s and that ended in 2004. So anti-Tehri Dam movement was basically, you know, started again by, you know, Sundar Lal Bahuguna, right? It was again, you know, the dam construction which was planned in 1960s, way back, but it was ultimately formalized in 1980s, right? There was lot of issues like displacement of the people, right, you know, environmental consequences, ecological consequences. So that basically the anti-Tehri Dam movement was basically started, and this Tehri Dam is going to be constructed over the Bhagirathi River, right? That is the main tributary of Ganga, right, in the hills of Uttarakhand. So you could understand that is going to be constructed on the upstream of the river Ganga, right? Specifically the biggest river in Ganga, right? And that movement was specifically started in 1978. So, and that was one of the most active movement at that point of the time to save the ecology and the environment, right, from such, you know, infrastructure development. So he also fought untouchability, and later he also started, you know, some sort of a squad for the purpose of anti-liquid drive, right, from 1965 to 1970. And he, for the personal reason, he adopted the Gandhian principles for his life, and he always followed the Gandhi's principles, right? And in 2009, he was awarded the Padma Bhushan Award by the government of India for his noted contribution for the environmental conservation and environmental protection. So he was Sundar Lal Bahuguna, who was great environmentalist, right, and a social reformer also. Okay. Next, the insurance sector. Now you must understand, here the government has allowed the foreign direct investment limit for the purpose of the insurance, right, from 49% to 74%. Now if the government has already allowed, the foreign direct investment in the insurance sector from 49 to 74%, you could also understand that, the Indian promoters, specifically in the joint venture means where you will have the two or more partners, right? So here you would have to have, certain board members in that. Now, these Indian promoters will no longer be able to nominate their majority members, because now the FDI limit in the insurance sector have been increased. So as per rules, they are no longer able to nominate the majority of the board members. Like here, they still able to nominate some of the key management persons, like you will have the chairperson of the board or MD or the CEO, right? Which need to be Indian resident Indians at that point of the time. Okay. Now, this norm will apply to the all insurers irrespective of their stakeholders. That means this FDI norm, which is from 49% to 74%, that will be applicable to all insurers. And that norm that will further, where the foreign investment or, foreign direct investment have been increased, exceed to 49%, there would be some specific, changes that would be made by the Ministry of Finance in that respect. All right. Next, you have the Kalakshetra Foundation, right? So here the Kalakshetra Foundation was basically the institution of the national importance. So here the central government nominated the 12 eminent artists and the musicians as a member of governing board of Kalakshetra Foundation. All right. So what is that Kalakshetra Foundation? How the government is able to nominate those eminent artists and the musicians in that respect? So Kalakshetra Foundation is basically is an art and cultural academy, right, which is of national importance as was dedicated by or as was disclosed by the parliament, right? And now it is basically one of the the topmost institutions, right, which is dedicated for the preservation of the traditional values, specifically Indian art, Indian crafts, right? And it is specifically devoted in the field of the Bharatanatyam dance and the Gandharva music. Okay. And this Kalakshetra Academy is basically based in Chennai, Tamil Nadu. Now, let us understand briefly about this Bharatanatyam dance. So, Bharatanatyam dance is basically a major form of the Indian classical dance, right? And as you know that it is mainly originated in Tamil Nadu, right? And the Bharatanatyam is one of the oldest classical dance traditions in India. And it was nurtured in the temples in the courts of the southern India since the ancient era time, right? And what is this Gandharva music? See, Gandharva Veda music. See, Gandharva Veda music, let me give you some of the background for that. So, as you know that thousands of the years ago, right, in India, the great rishis means the sadhus, right, they basically recognize, right, within their own consciousness, some sort of the rhythms and the enlightenment melodies of the Vedas. Okay. Now, which is the purest knowledge, right, at the basis of the nature, right? So, at the part of the Veda, the Gandharva Veda is the tradition of the musical performance that replicate the vibrations of the nature at the different times of the day and night and during the different seasons of the year. So, I would again repeat, the Gandharva Veda that we are talking about is a part of Veda, okay? It's a tradition of the music performance or the musical performance, right, that replicate the vibrations of the nature, right, that is what we call the Gandharva Veda, right, at the different times of the day or night, right, or even during different seasons of the year. So here the Mahesh Yogi was basically revived this tradition for that purpose, all right. And it was founded in 1936 by the Rukmani Devi Arundhale and her husband George Arundhale. They was also the social reformer and the freedom fighter, okay. And in 1994, an act of the parliament was passed, and under this act of the parliament, the Kalakshetra Foundation was also given the status of the institution of the national importance like IITs, right? And the Kalakshetra style of Bharatanatyam basically developed by the Rukmini Devi Ayodhale, right? And that will have some of the special, significance. For example, for its angular and straight and ballet-like kinesthetics. What is this kinesthetics? So kinesthetics learning that we are talking about is basically a tactical learning. That is the learning style in which the learning takes place by the students, right, that carry out the physical activities, right, rather than just listening to the, to the lectures and watching demonstrations. And that is the Rukmani Devi, Arundhale was also use a different tactic like the avoidance of this rekakas. What is this rekakas? Karakakas basically are the elements in some classical Indian dance styles. They are the elements, right, that describe some of the minor vibrations in the main moves that we wear whenever we used to do this classical dances. So some minor variations that are there in the main moves of those classical dance that are basically called the rakakas, and that is also inhabited to throw, right, of the limbs. That is the special features with that the Rukmani Devi Arundhale. Okay, here you could see the dance which is associated with the Bharatanatyam with Kalakshetra Academy. Okay, next, the mobile monitoring software app or the area officer monitoring app. So here the Union Minister of Rural Development have launched this two app that is called the mobile monitoring software app. Okay, and the second is basically area officer monitoring app. Now you must understand what is the purpose of this. So this national mobile monitoring app basically permits, right, for example, in the MNREGA or Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, right, under which some of the the unskilled labor is basically guaranteed for the rural people, specifically in the rural areas, right? So in order to ensure that the workers are available on the site, they are working, right, how would you do that? You would geotag their photographs, right, where you could easily see that the workers are working, and you could see that citizens oversight will also be there for the purpose of these programs, and also the payment related issues will also be resolved over the period of the time. So this national mobile monitoring software app would basically allow the geotag photographs, the real time attendance of those workers which are working with respect to MG NREGA, and also it will facilitate the payments of those workers at a faster pace. And the second is basically the area officer monitoring app that will facilitate the officers which are working on the field level to record their findings, right, with respect to the coordinated geotag photographs, with respect to all schemes that we are talking about, for example, MG NREGA, or the second scheme that we are talking about, that Pradhan Mantri, Awas Yojana Grameen, or Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, that is basically all about, the development to record their findings at the grassroots level. So let us understand briefly about those schemes. So first of all, let me give you a brief understanding about MG NREGA. So MG NREGA is basically Mahatma Gandhi Employment Guarantee Act that was passed in 2005. Right, here the MG NREGA will provide you some sort of a unskilled labor guarantee. That means it basically provides some sort of social security measure. It basically guarantees the worker, right, or the basically guaranteed the basically rural people the right to work, the social security, right, which is the most important aspect for 100 days of unskilled labor that will be provided for the rural people right here. And what about this Mahatma Gandhi Awas Yojana Grameen? So here Mahatma Gandhi Awas Yojana Grameen was introduced, right, with a boost or with a view of boosting the housing for all scheme that was to be achieved by the year 2022. So main aim of this Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Grameen is to provide a pakka house, right, with some basic amenities to those to those people. And what about the Prime Minister Grameen Sadak Yojana or Gram Sadak Yojana, right? It is the Prime Minister Gram Sadak Yojana is basically again a nationwide plan in India to provide a good all-weather road connectivity to all unconnected villages, right? That means to metal connectivity to all weather road connectivity to those unconnected villages, right? And that app would also would have better record keepings of the inspections by the field and the supervisory officials, right? That will also facilitate the better program implementation, the better finding, the better program formulations, etc., that will definitely help to the people also. All right, next, the surplus transfer to the Government of India by the RBI. Now here you must understand every year the RBI basically transfers some of the surplus amount in terms of money to the Government of India's account. So here the Reserve Bank of India announced this year for the purpose of from July 2020 to March 2021 for that year, right, for the 9 month period, around 99,122 crore, right, surplus amount have been transferred by the Reserve Bank of India to the Government of India, right? It is higher than expected, right, which is basically in terms of the dividend or the surplus which is being transferred to the government, right? And the government is expecting, as because of COVID-19, right, there is some sort of a shortage in terms of the tax collections, because the tax collectors or those tax officials or the people are unable to pay the tax on the time. So definitely there is a sharp fall in the tax collections due to the COVID restrictions, right? And the surplus is likely to reflect in the central bank's, you know, higher income because of the open market operations as well as the receipts in the financial, you know, exchange sales. What is that? So first of all, let us understand what is this open market operations that we are talking about. The open market operation basically refers to, you know, some sort of a practice that that the central bank here, the Reserve Bank of India, used to do, right? In which they basically buy or sell. The central banks basically buy or sell some sort of a treasury or the securities, right, in the open market, right? And that is basically done to regulate, you know, the money supply or the liquidity in the market, right? And what is about this foreign exchange sales? See. This, in order to understand this foreign exchange sale, you must understand, for example, any corporate foreign exchange transaction involve a bank. You must understand any corporate financial exchange sale or the transaction require a bank, right, on behalf of that corporate client. You're getting my point? And the payment for the purpose of currency, right, it's sold to and at agreed rate to another bank, and that is basically receiving a different currency in return for the purpose of this fund being cleared and settled in the local clearing. And in that process, the banks also earn some money for that purpose. Okay. And here, the government has already budgeted that a surplus of around 50,000 crore rupees, right, would be received from the RBI. That would be accounted for the purpose of 2021-22. Right. And here, in the previous full accounting year, the RBI has transferred around 57,128 crore rupees as a surplus amount to the government of India. And in 2018-2019, that was, you know, the highest ever transfer by the Reserve Bank of India to the government of India. And that year, financial year 19 means 2018-19, right, in that year 1.76 lakh crore rupees, right, have been transferred to the government. You must understand, and that is the one-time transfer that is basically, you know, given to the government. Here the government is likely to find it very, very challenging to meet the privatization target and disinvestment target that is of $24 billion, right, when you have, you know, such type of conditions like COVID-19, you know, restrictions, and GST's revenue are also likely to fall in that scenario. So here it will be very challenging to meet the privatization and the disinvestment target that the government of India having with them. Okay. And the Reserve Bank of India also decided to maintain this contingency risk buffer. This contingency risk buffer of 5.5%, right? It is very, very difficult to maintain that also, right? Because you must understand this contingency risk buffer that we are talking about is basically, you know, it's a risk provisioning, right, that made from the economic capital to cover the monetary, you know, the fiscal stability, the credit and operational risk, that is cumulatively referred to as, you know, the contingency risk buffer. So here the RBI would also maintain this contingency risk buffer for the purpose to, you know, from the economic capital to cover these monetary, fiscal stability, the credit and operational risk, right, for that purpose. And here the RBI will move to an April to March an accounting year from 2021-22, right, from the July to June last year. So that is another move that has been taken recently. Here you could see the RBI surplus transfer that has been fluctuating over the years, right. In financial year 2019, you could see 1.76 lakh crore rupees have been transferred by the RBI. That was the highest, right. But again this year, right, 2020-21, right, that is only 99,000 crore rupees have been transferred. Again, in 2010-2011, there was 15,000 crore rupees. So you could see this fluctuation, but again, it is on the higher side. So again, we could see in the future prospect also is grim. All right. Next, the Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay National Welfare Fund for the sports persons. So here you must understand, this is the scheme which was introduced by the Ministry of Youth Affairs and the Sports or Government of India for the purpose of providing some sort of a financial incentives to those sports person who are basically living in, you know, some sort of a, you know, the poor condition or the needy condition. So here the Ministry of Youth Affairs under the Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay National Welfare Fund for the sports person, under that fund, 2 lakh rupees have been provided to the Karnataka sport person known as B. Tejaswini Bai. B. Tejaswini Bai, who was also won the Arjuna Award in 2011, right,
and she was also a member of the women kabaddi team, and she won the gold medal in 2010 and 2014 Asian Games respectively. Recently, her husband had died because of the COVID-19 complications, and you must understand the hardship that she is facing, and the government of India has decided to give this 2 lakhs rupees as the amount to the needy sports person in that regard. So here, this financial assistance which has been provided from Pandit Deel Dayal Upadhyay National Welfare Fund for the sports person, that has been provided as under jointly collaborated scheme, that is from the Sports Authority of India, the Indian Olympic Association, right, to support some of the ex international athletes and the coaches, right, during such COVID-19 pandemic. All right, so this fund was set up in 1982, right? That is, the fund was set up in 1982 in order to provide the outstanding, in order to provide the financial assistance to the outstanding sports persons, right, of the yesteryear. What is yesteryear? Yesteryear means last year or the recent past, right? Specifically that we recall, that is called yesteryear, right? And those sports persons which are living in the indigent circumstances. Indigent means the poor and the needy circumstances, right? So here, from this fund, the money will be given to them. Here, the 2 lakhs rupees have been provided to the sports person, right? Here, the scheme is basically revised in May 2016, right? And here, the lump sum ex gratia is basically provided to the sports persons of the yesteryears, right? And the pension is basically already done away with, because there are already many schemes which provide the pensions to those meritorious sports person in our country. So here, the P. Tejaswini Bai, which is recovering from the COVID, and her husband, Naveen, was already succumbed to those virus on May 11th, that you would know already. Okay, now the government has given this financial assistance to P. Tejaswini Bai, right? All right. Next, the GST on imported oxygen concentrators. Now, the government of India has decided, right, to put, the GST on the oxygen concentrators for the personal use. Now, we are talking on the personal use. Previously, the GST that was imposed on the oxygen concentrator, that was 28%. But now the government of India has reduced this GST from 28% to just 12%. But now the people went to the court that for the purpose of the personal use, right, under right to life, under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution, right, that is unconstitutional and unfair and illegal to apply this GST on such, the oxygen concentrators. Now, that comes under the right to life. So here, the Delhi High Court has upheld, right, the government imposition of the Delhi High Court basically, declare unconstitutional the imposition of the 12% of the GST on the oxygen concentrators for the personal use. That means now there will not be any GST on the oxygen concentrators for the personal use as held by the Delhi High Court. Delhi High Court put that GST on the oxygen concentrators, unconstitutional, illegal, right here, because the oxygen concentrators constitute a life-saving device. During such pandemic, when you have the shortage of the oxygen, putting an extra burden on the patients by putting 12% of the GST would definitely, is against the fundamental rights under Article 21, that is right to life and personal liberty. So here, the petitioner challenged the May 1 notification that is basically reduced the GST from 28% to 12%. Again, the Honorable High Court has slashed down this 12% also. So here, the Honorable High Court have invoked Article 21 of the Constitution under Article 1221, which says that the fundamental right to life is also your fundamental right, and right to get the oxygen, right? The sufficient amount of oxygen is also as a part of the right to life here. Okay, the government has, the court has already asked the government to temporarily just dropping this 12% of the GST, but government did not listen for that. And now the High Court has declared it as unconstitutional. There was no other way for that. Okay, next, DIPCO van. The DIPCO van is basically a device, right? It is a basically antibody detection based kit that is called DIPCO van, right? This DIPCO van is developed by the Defense Institute of Physiology and the Allied Sciences, which is a laboratory with the Defense Research and Development Organization. It is basically an antibody detection kit. So here you must understand, this DIPCO van kit was detecting both, right, the proteins of the SARS-CoV-2 virus that is highly sensitive, that is, with some sort of a high sensitivity of 97% and 99%. So to detect that one, that the antibody detection kit was basically developed by the DRDO. Now regarding DRDO, as you know, right, it is a defense research and development organization, right? It is basically, you know, comes under the Ministry of Defense, Government of India. It is charged with the military research and the development, and its main purpose is basically to develop some sort of a defense technology systems product that are required for the Indian Armed Forces. Now let us understand about this, more about this Deep Covent. So Deep Covent basically intended to provide some sort of a qualitative detection of the IgG antibodies. The IgG antibodies. Okay, now I will come to that. What is this IgG antibodies? Okay, so it will try to try to count or try to detect this IgG antibodies in the human serum or in the plasma that targets your SARS-CoV-2 related antigens, right? So here it offers a significantly faster turnaround time, that it requires just 75 minutes, just 75 minutes to conduct the test, right? And that too without any cross reactivity with other diseases, right? So this this kit of maybe having the very immense useful, and that kit is also having the shelf life of around 18 months, right? So here the industry partners, you know, have been associated for the production of this kit, right? And here it will be useful for the understanding of the COVID-19 epidemiology and assessing the individual's previous SARS-CoV-2, you know, exposure. So let us understand what is this IgG antibodies, which is going to be detected by this Deep Covent kit. So IgG is also known as immunoglobulin. In immunoglobulin G, it is a particularly, you can say it is an antibody. It represents around 75% of the serum antibodies in the humans. So it is around 75% of the serum antibodies in the humans. So the IgG is the most common type of antibody that is found in the blood circulation. All right. And this IgG molecules are created and released by the plasma B cells, right? It's a type of cells, right? So in order to help to evaluate the person's immune system status, right? To detect and monitor and, you know, some sort of excess or the deficiency in one or more of this this immunoglobulin classes, right? This test is basically conducted. So you can understand that when you have, you know, the recurrent infections or the chronic diarrhea or whatever, you know, your healthcare practitioner or your doctor basically suspect some sort of immunoglobulin deficiency or excess of particularly immunoglobulin, right? You have to monitor that IgG antibodies in your body, right? In order to assess your the immune system status for that purpose, right? So this kit is basically developed in the association with the Vanguard Diagnostics Private Limited, right? To that will manufacture, right, this diagnostic kit, right? And here the Deepcovent is intended to provide some sort of a qualitative detection of this IgG antibody that now I have explained you, that has been found in the human serum or the plasma that basically targets the SARS-CoV-2 related antigens. Okay, so that will basically provide, you know, the shorter number of the time, that is around 75 minutes required for the conducting of this test, and that too without any reactivity, and that kit has a shelf life of around 18 months. All right, next you have the Ayush COVID-19 counseling helpline. So here the Ayush means, you must understand, Ayush means Ayurveda, homeopathy, yoga, naturopathy, Unani and Siddha, right? So here the, you know, the experts or the doctors, you know, from the Ayush, right, would be available, right, to address the queries of the general mass. So here the dedicated community support helpline have been operationalized by the Ministry of Ayush to provide the Ayush based approaches and the solutions to the people, right, which is basically having some sort of a traumatized conditions related to COVID-19. So a toll free number 1443 is being used for the purpose of contacting those experts from the Ministry of Ayush or the Ayush doctors, right? That helpline will be operational on the pan India basis from 6 a.m. morning to the 12 midnight, all the 7 days of a week. Okay, so here the experts from the different streams of Ayush, you know, or the Ayurveda, homeopathy, yoga, naturopathy, Unani and Siddha would be, you know, available to address your queries, your doubts related to the COVID-19 pandemic. All right, so that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. We will again meet tomorrow. Please take care, be safe, be at your home. Thank you very much.